saying. Humanity has not left in the world, but world has refused to see Kashmiris as humans. Good noon, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Manahil Khan, hailing from heavens on earth. But today, I'll talk about atrocities of Indian Army transforming this land into hell. I can talk less about its idyllic flowing rivers, but streams of blood have diverted my attention. Kashmir dispute reminds India and the world of their repeated initiatives made at top level, which guaranteed Kashmiri people of their future through a plebiscite. Kashmir would have referendum under the auspices of United Nations. Let's have a flashback, ladies and gentlemen. After the partition, based on declaration of British government, the status of formerly independent princely state of Jammu and Kashmir was contested by India and Pakistan, in which led to the first Kashmir war and subsequent ceasefire with the establishment of line of control, dividing Jammu and Kashmir between both countries. And this all was backed by United Nations resolution. And the story begins. Story of brutality, of genocide, of crime, of sexual assault in Indian-occupied Kashmir. India has stationed over 7 lakh armed military personnel in Indian-occupied Kashmir, which, by the way, is the largest concentration of occupation army in any conflict zone of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, to get their right of self-determination, to free themselves from Indian occupation, Kashmiris continued with their freedom struggle. And India tried to suppress it with brutal methods. India, along with Dogra forces and RSS extremists, has massacred over 2,37,000 unarmed Kashmiris. Human rights are violated in that part of land. Human rights violations include massacres, fake encounters, extrajudicial killing by judicial personnel, disappearances, and torture. Inhuman and illegal use of Armed Special Power Act. They're authorized to open fire, arrest without warrant, stop and search vehicles, and use kind of forces that can even cause death. Twice a week, ladies and gentlemen, twice a week, there is ceasefire violation at Haveli, Nakyal, and Poonch sector. Despite everything, India has not succeeded in suppressing this struggle in past 70 years, nor will it ever succeed in doing so. Allow me to remind you a few prominent instances of Indian brutality. Burhan Muzaffar Wani, a social media savvy Kashmiri who was mercilessly killed by Indian Army and whose killing led to the widespread protest. And since then, 15,000 Kashmiris have been injured, with 850 suffering from pellet injuries. They are turning them blind. And this doesn't end here, ladies and gentlemen. This doesn't. A 24-year-old Farooq Ahmed Dar, who was tied to the front of the military jeep and used as human shield against protesters. Let me allow to remind you an example what respecting human rights is. Yasin Malik, who is the chairman of a Kashmiri political party, has been captured many times by Indian Army. His wife, Michelle Malik, along with her daughter, lives in Pakistan, and she's longing to meet her husband. But here we are, letting a terrorist, a spy, Kulbhushan Yadav, meet his family. This is what I call respecting human rights. Now one can imagine where Indian government stands, who's trying to demonize the struggle of innocent Kashmiris as an act of terrorism and presenting itself as victim. And the worst part, they've also tried to remove Kashmiris from Kashmir issue, making it a bilateral issue between Pakistan and India. Let them know, Kashmiris are the people who have to decide their future through a plebiscite. I'm done with the cliché part. Let's face it, we all know Indian brutality in Kashmir. Kashmiris' struggle for self-determination had been ignored by international community and sacrificed by United Nations. 70 years down the road, the issue remains unresolved. Geopolitical and geoeconomic aspirations of global and regional players seem to have taken precedence over gross human rights violation taking place in Jammu and Kashmir. Now is the time to stop playing this blame game, to stop living in the past, and to stand up. We are the generation who can solve this issue if we make right use of our social media. Yes, social media. If we leverage the strength of our diaspora, and if we make Pakistan and Azad Kashmir stronger. Acknowledging the fact India is trying to demonize us and destabilize us by sponsored terrorism, we have to stand more firmly on our grounds. And I ask Her Excellency to strive harder about that part, to remove, to give up intransigence and fulfill international commitments and create conducive atmosphere for the implementation of United Nations resolution. And I ask my peers one single question to ponder upon. Do our social media need stories of our personal lives? Or we can use that tool to help our country solve issues like Kashmir dispute. After all, there's always a bright light at the end of the darkest tunnels. Thank you so much for listening to me.